So when I bought my clavichord in 2008, my plan was to use this beautiful instrument mainly to perform music of J.S. Bach. As many musicians, also I thought of the clavichord as an instrument for music of before 1750. That position on itself was not so strange, because back then, and still actually today, one could say, well, music by Bach was seen as written mainly for the harpsichord and not the clavichord, though things are evolving rapidly now. But when the instrument arrived in August 2009, its 5-octave compass kept inviting me for not only Bach, but also for music of a later date. Mozart, one of my all-time musical heroes, was taken from the shelf again and put on the music stand. And from the first notes, a completely new world opened for me. So joyful that for a while, Bach even had to accept being put aside. And so, after having played lots of music of Mozart, still in my pre-YouTube time, I one day thought, well, why not do something really crazy and try some Beethoven sonatas? If I'm not mistaken, this must have been somewhere around 2011-2012, and in fact, one could say that our Beethoven project, that is about to start with the arrival of the new Fritz pianoforte soon, and in fact has started more or less with the historical Frenzel over there already now, that Beethoven project was initiated in that moment at my clavichord. So, after having played a few years only music until Mozart with lots of Haydn as well, my first renewed Beethoven impression was that of a total shock. It's hard to explain what the effect is when you live in a kind of cocoon, as I did at the time, being very focused to music of a certain period, and then, after some years, again play Beethoven. My first reaction, I still remember this very well today, was that of checking Beethoven's date of birth again. I was utterly confused from playing his F minor sonata, the first one only. It seemed to me as if there was a generation missing compared to Mozart's latest keyboard works. How on earth was it possible that a guy of barely 25 years old had the energy and creational power to catapult music history and musical styles into a new era? Still today, that's a question that puzzles me, though by playing Beethoven I've learned new perspectives on Mozart and Haydn's music as well. And of course, there is a logical, or certainly a kind of logical connection from one generation to another, but still, what Beethoven has done with music and development of style is beyond comprehension. And how did the clavichord respond? It became clear soon that Beethoven composed for the future. And as late as the 1790s, yes, the clavichord was still very prominent in many, if not all, of the working rooms of musicians and composers. But the pianoforte by that time was more or less the established instrument for at least the top player of musicians and society, and certainly in Vienna. But it's not hard to feel, yet way harder to describe, that Beethoven still had that classical 18th century hand in mind when writing his music, that more or less closed hand position that the clavichord really needs to make sound. And though there is still a debate whether one needs to use a sustaining pedal for those early sonatas or not, the clavichord does not really miss it for that music. Not saying one could add some pedaling to those early sonatas, but it's very well possible without. What surprised me also was only then seeing that a large part of Beethoven's sonatas were written in a relatively short period of time. His famous Waldstein sonata is already number 21 of 32 sonatas and already composed as early as 1804. That doesn't mean, however, that all these works are possible to perform on the clavichord. If you would be interested in a series in which I go through his sonatas from the perspective which ones still work on the clavichord and which ones don't, let me know in the comments below. I'm more than happy to do so. But keep in mind that for some recordings I made here on YouTube, I already pushed the limits in a way you hopefully will not hear. But certainly some movements are on the edge of what is technically still possible on the clavichord. Yes, I did play the first movement of his Waldstein sonata on clavichord, but in fact that one is almost impossible to be performed on this instrument. Again, I could go more in detail on what it exactly means playing on the edge, but that would take us a bit too far here for this video. My point here is that as I kind of felt Beethoven's way of keyboard writing on the clavichord, it's not hard to feel he was trained as a true 18th century keyboard player, thinking still a lot from within this particular way of playing while composing. But he rapidly changed to a technique for which he no doubt had the pianoforte in mind. So I thought Beethoven left the clavichord behind from about 1800 onwards. Since why would he play an instrument that was not fully capable anymore on delivering on the true spirit of his own compositions? So guess how surprised I was when Lorenz Guardian called me one late Sunday evening, pointing to a quote he found in this book, written by Siegfried Rampe on Beethoven's keyboards and his art of improvisation. On page 38 we read the following. I'll read it first in German and then translate. The quote is taken from Beethoven's Konversationshefte, the conversation notebooks, little notebooks in which people wrote down the things they wanted to communicate with the composer who suffered more and more from hearing losses. This particular entry is written by Beethoven's nephew in the summer of 1825, and I quote, Morgen kommt der Klavierstimmer von Leschen. Weil das Klavichord schon sehr verstimmt ist, schon seit mehr als 4 Wochen, dem muss ich auch etwas geben. Or in English, the keyboard tuner von Leschen will come tomorrow, since the clavichord is out of tune for more than 4 weeks. I'll have to give him also something. So, interesting here is that the clavichord as an instrument is explicitly called a clavichord and not, what often happens in the German language, simply Klavier. So it is absolutely certain that in the summer of 1825, Beethoven still had a clavichord. And not only that, he had a clavichord that needed to be in tune. But why? Why a clavichord if it couldn't serve Beethoven for his music anymore? And moreover, why the need to tune such a soft-sounding instrument for a musician who could barely still hear his piano? If you hope to get an exact answer to these questions, I have to disappoint you, since the best I can do is make some guesses. The clavichord that was tuned in the summer of 1825 in Beethoven's house was not present anymore at the time the composer died. So either he gave it to someone before he passed away, or sold it. Perhaps it was still the Tiefenbrunner clavichord Count Waldstein, yes, the one of the sonata, gave him as a farewell present when he left Bonn. I'll give you some images here on screen of such clavichord, the one that's preserved in the Collection du Musée Philharmonie Paris. Of that instrument, it is sometimes said it is the one Beethoven owned, but I do not think this has been factually confirmed. If you know more about this, please leave it in the comment section. More than happy to read that. Anyway, did Beethoven still use it as an instrument to compose? As also, for instance, Mozart and many other composers used clavichords to not only perform on, but to compose as well. Some people I talked on this particular fact and quote, people that know way more than I on the history of the clavichord did not know this particular entry in the Conversationshefte, but they gave all the same answer that since playing the clavichord gives constant contact with the vibrating strings, Beethoven might have felt the vibration still. But my guess is that this is not the case. I've tried it myself, but one actually do not feel the vibrations of the string through the keys, and even if so, the vibrations would be too soft to kind of feel the sound. I could just make one guess, it would be that Beethoven used this clavichord for composition. Perhaps because he was used to compose at it, as the Tiefenbrunner instrument was in fact designed for composition, seeing the ink pot even built into the instrument. Sometimes just feeling the keys is enough to project the sound of the chord or harmony. But why it then needed to be in tune? I have actually no idea. Did Beethoven still demonstrate some things to visitors? Or was it simply because the people who were present at the time he composed enjoyed a tuned clavichord more than one completely out of tune? You know, that people played Beethoven still more on clavichord than we today think is also true. You might remember a video I've made a long time ago on Gottlob Türk, second generation Bach student and the author of the still today famous book on keyboard playing, Die Klavierschule, published in 1789. If you want to see the context there to have some more Beethoven inspiration, you can click on the video over here. You will be following the back then famous singer and composer Karel Leuwe into Türk's study room when applying to become a student. If you like the video, please give it a thumbs up, subscribe for more videos, and for now, thank you all for watching. See you soon again. Bye.